So that this is how I check. It's not very scientific. Really. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It has been. It's been an incredible journey that I believe will culminate on November 8th when we begin to make America great again. I got to tell you, I joined this campaign in a heartbeat because you have nominated a man for president who never quits, who never backs down. He is a fighter. He is a winner. Until not too long ago, it seemed like he was out there fighting all on his own. But now this movement is coming together. Ohio is coming together. This country's coming together. And we're going to make Donald Trump the next president of the United States of America. You know, we've gotten to know Donald Trump and his family over the last 3 months. And as people ask me all the time, what is it about Donald Trump? I'm from south of Highway 40 over in Indiana, so we speak pretty plainly there. So I tell people, just Donald Trump just gets it, you know? I mean, in a very real sense, he has given voice to the aspirations and frustrations of the American people like no one in my lifetime since Ronald Reagan. I mean, we live in a time when the American people are tired of being told. Am I right about that? I mean, we're tired of being told this is as good as it gets. And frankly, we're tired of being told by leaders in both political parties that they'll eventually get around to solving these big and intractable problems, but just not yet. We're frankly tired of being told, as Ronald Reagan said so many years ago, that a little intellectual elite in a far distant capital can plan our lives better for us than we can plan them for ourselves. The truth is, Donald Trump hears that voice of the American people. He literally embodies the spirit of America. Strong, freedom-loving, independent, optimistic, and willing to fight every day for the ideals of this nation and for the American people. And he's going to make a great president of the United States. You saw that willingness to fight in Vegas just the other night, didn't you? When he beat Hillary Clinton in the third debate, hands down. I'm going to talk a little bit about that debate this morning. It was very informative. I got to give Chris Wallace a lot of credit, because he really asked the kind of questions the American people wanted to hear answers to. Not that they got too many of them, but we'll talk a little bit before I take my leave about some of the answers that we heard were incredibly illuminating. You know, we actually had a little debate of our own in Farmville, Virginia, against my opponent in the vice presidential contest. I want to apologize. We're running a little bit late this morning because we stopped for breakfast once we landed in Columbus, and Senator Tim Kaine called to interrupt me 5 times during breakfast. And I just can't seem to get away from that guy. Some people think I won that debate in Farmville, Virginia. And thank you. Thank you for that. I would tell you that from where I was sitting, Donald Trump won that debate. Donald Trump's vision for this country won that debate. And Donald Trump's determination to make America great again is going to win all the way to the White House in the next 17 days. You know, and it's not like it's exactly a fair fight out there. You know, I don't know about the rest of you. I get up every morning. I got to turn on the television with a stick. You know, do you get me on that? I'm just not sure what's going to be there any given morning. It seems like, you know, the media goes chasing after just every different potential attack against my opponent every single day of the week, and while they ignore this avalanche of controversies and scandals pouring out of Hillary Clinton's years as Secretary of State. It really is remarkable. I mean, I could literally spend all this morning talking about revelations that we found out. But let me just mention a couple of them, because it's not like you're going to hear them in the news, okay? I mean, USA Today, give them a little bit of credit. They actually wrote this week that after looking at this avalanche of emails, they said, quote, the nexus among private companies, Hillary Clinton's State Department, and the Clinton Family Foundation is closer and more complex than Donald Trump has even claimed so far. I mean, they said at least a dozen companies that gave money to the Clinton Family Foundation, get this, a dozen companies that gave money to the Clinton Family Foundation over here also lobbied the State Department while she was Secretary of State And then the lobbyists that they hired were people that were raising money for Hillary Clinton's campaign. Then we found out because of freedom of information requests from ABC News that during the period following the terrible earthquake in Haiti, that when $10 billion was being made available to rebuild that country after that devastating natural disaster, that aides for the Secretary of State said that businesses that were friends of the Clintons should be flagged for contracts in Haiti, and everybody else would just go to the public website. And worst of all is, just about a week ago, the FBI actually confirmed that officials at the State Department offered a quid pro quo to the FBI if they would be willing to change the classification status of emails, some of which had to do with Benghazi, that were on her private server. I mean, the truth of the matter is, men and women, the American people are tired of pay-to-play politics in Washington, D.C. And it's exactly the kind of politics. It's exactly the kind of politics that's going to come to a crashing end the day that Donald Trump becomes president of the United States of America. Donald Trump has a plan. He's going to talk about it again in Gettysburg this morning. He has a plan to basically reform ethics in our nation's capital, 5-year ban on executive branch officials leaving government, becoming lobbyists, the same thing for members of Congress. And here's my personal favorite, the past campaign finance reform that says that registered foreign lobbyists cannot raise money in American political campaigns. This is our country. I mean, Donald Trump is going to drain the swamp in Washington, D.C., and we're going to have government as good as our people again. So if only to restore the highest standard of ethics in our nation's capital and in the highest office of the land, can I just ask you all here in Ohio, do all you can in the next 17 days to make sure that Hillary Clinton is never elected president of the United States of America. Because at the end of the day, but at the end of the day, this election is about bigger things than their small ethics. And that's really what I want to talk to you about today. Because in the 17 days that you have in front of you, I want you to reach out to neighbors and friends at worship and at work over backyard fences. And I want you to talk to your neighbors about the big issues. I mean, we all know about these things swirling around the Democratic nominee. But I don't think we've paid enough careful attention to the issues of security and prosperity, and most especially to the Supreme Court of the United States of America. And I want to talk to you about those things this morning. On the subject of security, it's important to note, despite traveling millions of miles as our Secretary of State and being the architect of the Obama foreign policy, the world is more dangerous today than the day that Hillary Clinton became Secretary of State and Barack Obama became president. Our allies are less secure. Our enemies are more emboldened. 7.5 years of Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton's leadership on the foreign stage has weakened America's place in the world. All you need to do is look at a map of the wider Middle East to see civil war, unrest, the rise and reign and rule of ISIS overrunning vast areas that have been won by the American soldier in Operation Iraqi Freedom. You know, history teaches that weakness arouses evil. And I would submit to you that the record of this administration of leading from behind, moving red lines, feigning resets with Russia, is emblematic of that truth of history. It's important to remember that it was Hillary Clinton who initiated that disastrous agreement with the radical mullahs in Iran. The leading state sponsor of terrorism received $150 billion, including $1.7 billion in a ransom payment, 400 million of which arrived the day that they released 4 American hostages. Let me make you a promise. When Donald Trump becomes president of the United States, we won't be paying ransom to terror-sponsoring states. They'll be paying a price. It was Hillary Clinton. It was Hillary Clinton who failed to negotiate an agreement with the sovereign nation of Iraq that would have allowed American soldiers to remain and safeguard what had been won at extraordinary sacrifice by the American soldier and by the Iraqi people in Operation Iraqi Freedom. The vacuum that was created after 2012 literally became the platform in which ISIS was able to be conjured up out of the desert sands to overrun vast areas that had been won by the American soldier. You know, when I was a member of Congress, Ralph was talking about my record in that time. I actually traveled downrange to visit our soldiers in Iraq and Afghanistan every single year. I remember the extraordinary sacrifices that our soldiers and their families made. Karen and I have stood quietly and prayed at the graveside of Hoosiers who fell in defending our freedom and advancing the freedom and security of the people of Iraq. Before I go one step further, if you're able to stand or otherwise raise your hand, if you wore the uniform of the United States of America, could the men and women who have served our nation in uniform, would you mind rising and standing and giving us a chance just to say thanks one more time? Thanks for your service. I mean, the American soldier won the peace and security in Iraq by the end of 2008, and it literally was squandered by this administration. And today, as we stand here today, I encourage you to remember in prayer more than 5,000 special forces that are a part of taking back Mosul, a community of over a million people that's having to be won back today because it was lost to ISIS in this administration. And lastly, it was Hillary Clinton and her State Department who left Americans in harm's way in Benghazi. And after four Americans fell, she told the parents, like Pat Smith, of our fallen heroes, that it was because of a filmmaker in the United States, a spontaneous riot, when, in fact, we would learn because Congress investigated it, that she wrote an email to a family member the night of the attack, September the 11th, saying that it was a terrorist-style al-Qaeda attack. When she was questioned before the Congress about that, she said words that ring into history. She said, quote, "What difference at this point does it make?" Well, let me tell you, as the proud father of a United States Marine, anyone who said that, anyone who did that, should be disqualified from ever serving as Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of the United States of America. We cannot have four more years apologizing to our enemies and abandoning our friends. We cannot have four more years with the kind of military cutbacks that have left us with the lowest troop level since 1940, the smallest number of ships since 1916, Marine Corps battalions hollowed out, down from 36 battalions to 23. Men and women, for the world to be safe, for the American people to be secure, America must be strong. And Donald Trump will lead on the world stage with American strength. We will rebuild our military. We will restore the arsenal of democracy. We will rebuild the American Navy to 350 ships so we can protect our nation and ensure that the sea lanes around the world are open and secure. We will give our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines the resources and training they need to accomplish their mission. And we will hunt down and destroy ISIS at its source, so that our nation and our allies will be secure. So it is about security. But it's not just security abroad, it's also safety here at home. You know, this is a very challenging time for men and women in law enforcement in this country. It seems like every time there's tragedy in the wake of law enforcement officers doing their jobs, there's some on the left and some in the national media who are willing to paint with a broad brush to be critical, to literally accuse the men and women in law enforcement of being a force for division in our country. Well, Donald Trump and I think different. We know men and women who serve in law enforcement are not a force for division in America. They are a force for good. They are the best of us. There's a lot of members of law enforcement who are here today. Would you mind just showing these members of the law enforcement community here in Ohio how much we appreciate the job that they and their families do to protect our families and serve our communities? Thank you. I'm going to promise you, when Donald Trump becomes the chief law enforcement officer of the United States of America, Donald Trump will support our law enforcement at every level. We will provide them with the resources and the training they need to protect our families and come home safe to theirs. And we will restore law and order to every city and every community in the United States. That's probably why Donald Trump was endorsed by the 330,000 members of the Fraternal Order of Police to be the next president of the United States of America. So it's about security. Security abroad and safety at home, but it's also about prosperity. You know, we're in the midst of the weakest economic recovery since the Great Depression. We have the lowest labor participation rate since the 1970s. Hillary Clinton's plan is more of the same. More taxes, more regulation, more Obamacare, more of the kind of war on energy that's been stifling American jobs. You know, they tell us this economy is the best we can do. Hang in there. That 1% economy is going to come around, right? But I think you people in the Buckeye State know a little bit better. It's not the best we can do. It's just the best they can do. And when Donald Trump becomes president of the United States of America, we're going to put common sense, conservative principles into practice, and we're going to get this economy moving again and put America back to work. Donald Trump's got a plan. He's got a plan to get this economy moving again. It looks a whole lot like a plan the 40th president put into effect back in the 1980s. When Donald Trump's reelected, and I want you to reelect Senator Rob Portman from the great state of Ohio. With Republican majorities in the House and Senate, we're going to cut taxes across the board for working families, small businesses, and family farms. Not a tax increase, but a tax reduction. We're going to get rid of death taxes once and for all. We're going to lower business taxes in America, and we're going to repeal every single Obama executive order that is stifling jobs and growth in the American economy. We're going to have the kind of trade deals that support jobs in America first. Donald Trump and I know that trade means jobs. Exports here in Ohio support jobs here in Ohio. Imports keep the cost of goods low. But we're going to make sure when Donald Trump becomes negotiator-in-chief that when trade means jobs, trade means American jobs first. And we're going to have the kind of deals that put the American economy at the top of the list. When Donald Trump becomes president of the United States, also we're going to, day one, the war on coal is going to come to a crashing halt. We're going to develop all the resources of this land. All of the above energy strategy that will drive an American renewal. And lastly, when Donald Trump becomes president of the United States, we're going to work with that reelected Congress, and we're going to pry off the back of the American economy that unaffordable Affordable Care Act. I don't know if you heard about President Obama's speech. We had a couple days ago in Miami, they were celebrating the third anniversary of Obamacare. The launch of Obamacare. I was actually in the Congress when we fought against this thing. And every single one of us said that what's going to happen is the premiums are going to go up and coverage is going to go down, which is exactly what's happened, which is why former President Clinton said it's the craziest thing in the world the other day. But that's not the best line. President Obama this week, literally, he compared Obamacare, I'm not making this up, he compared Obamacare to the Samsung Galaxy 7 phones, which have been spontaneously bursting into flames. He did. Here's the quote. Quote, this is President Obama. When one of these companies comes out with a new smartphone and has a few bugs, what do? They fix it. They upgrade it. Unless it catches fire, then they pull it off the market. Well, Mr. President, that's exactly what we're going to do with Obamacare. We're going to pull it off the market. We're going to repeal it lock, stock, and barrel. And we're going to replace it with the kind of health care reform that lowers the cost of health insurance without growing the size of government. We're going to use the power of the free market to meet the health insurance needs of the American people. That's how you solve problems the American way. Wow. But finally, as we talk about security and we talk about prosperity, I expect you've come to this summit today to talk about the issues that bear upon our values. And they're perhaps most significant of all. And the truth of the matter is, with the passing of the late and great Justice Antonin Scalia, issues of life and liberty and the very interpretation of our Constitution is literally on the ballot as the Supreme Court of the United States. The direction of the court will be decided in this very same election. I mean, elect Hillary Clinton as President of the United States, and you can get used to more unelected judges using unaccountable power to make unconstitutional decisions. If you doubted that, you should have watched that debate the other night. Right out of the gate, she got a question about the Supreme Court, and I pulled the quote. Hillary Clinton was asked her philosophy on appointments to the Supreme Court. She said this, quote, "The Supreme Court should represent all of us. That's how I see the court. And the kind of people I would be looking for to nominate would be in the great tradition of standing up to the powerful, standing up on behalf of our rights as Americans." Well, the Wall Street Journal actually wrote these words yesterday, and I can't say them any better. They wrote, "The Supreme Court doesn't or shouldn't represent anyone. It is the U.S. system. In the U.S. system, that's the job of the representative portions of our government. The purpose of the Supreme Court is to uphold the Constitution of the United States of America and strictly construe that Constitution and settle disputes." I have to tell you, the choice in this election with regard to the Supreme Court couldn't be more dramatic. Elect Hillary Clinton and you will have an activist court legislating from the bench. But you elect Donald Trump, take a look at that list of 21 jurists. We have the privilege of serving together. He said saying again this morning in Gettysburg, we'll choose a man or woman on that list. Strict constructionist of the Constitution of the United States of America, appointed to the highest court in the land, who will uphold our Constitution in the tradition of the late and great Justice Antonin Scalia. That's the choice on the court. It truly is extraordinary. But those aren't the only issues in this election bearing upon our values. I would submit to you, people who've known me well know I'm pro-life. I don't apologize for it. I think a society can be judged by how it deals with its most vulnerable, the aged, the infirm, the disabled, and the unborn. I was so proud to see my running mate this last Wednesday in Las Vegas take the position I've taken for a long time. I long to see the day that Roe versus Wade is sent to the ash heap of history where it belongs. But not just with the court or issues of life. And I want to pledge to you, Donald Trump and I have the opportunity to serve. We're going to be advancing the sanctity of life in the laws of this nation. We are going to sign a bill banning late-term abortion in the United States of America. The Late-Term Abortion Child Pain Act will be signed by President Trump. We will also uphold the historic ban on public funding of abortion. The Hyde Amendment will become permanent law in a Trump-Pence administration. And Donald Trump and I believe that the largest abortion provider in America should not be the largest recipient of federal funding under Title X, and we will defund Planned Parenthood and redirect those dollars to women's health care services that don't also provide abortion. Men and women, it's about the Supreme Court. It's about life. But it's also about our fundamental liberties. You know, there's a great story about Donald Trump. It was about 6 months ago, maybe longer. I think Ralph Reed was actually at this meeting. But he was meeting with a group of pastors, and they'd expressed their support for the vision that I just described for you about security and prosperity and the sanctity of life. And Donald looked at him, as he invariably does, and he asked for the order. He said, well, can you go back and can you just tell your congregations that you're for me? And several of them kind of looked down and said, well, actually, no, we can't. And he said, why? And they explained to him a law that's been in place since the 1950s. It's the Johnson Amendment. It was added by a Senator, Lyndon Johnson. It essentially says that churches just like the one we're standing in today could lose their tax-exempt status if they support or oppose a candidate for federal office. And in a very real sense, the Johnson Amendment has been the law of the land for more than a half of a century. Well, Donald Trump, you know, I like to say to people, politicians are people that ask how things are. Leaders are people that ask why. And I couldn't be more proud of the fact that because of Donald Trump's leadership, for the first time in the history of our party, the full repeal of the Johnson Amendment is in the Republican Party platform, and we'll sign it into law. And this is not a small matter. You know, I studied American history as an undergraduate, and I've got a lifelong love of the study of the American founding and the great progress of this country. You know, if you think of the voice of faith throughout the history of this country, I mean, most of the most powerful speeches given for independence in the American founding were actually sermons that were then distributed as pamphlets. I mean, if you think of the abolition of slavery, Harriet Beecher Stowe's father, it was those thundering sermons that challenged the conscience of a nation that ended the scourge of slavery in America. You think of the civil rights movement and in the pews of Dr. King's church in Montgomery, Alabama. Karen and I have actually sat in those pews with people that were a part of that movement, and they told us we would gather here, we would sing, and we would pray, and then we would march. I would submit to you today, this is no small matter, that in the life of this nation, freeing up the voice of communities of faith will make America stronger and more prosperous in our third century. I believe it with all of my heart. So let me just simply close and thank you for your patience this morning. I know I've been a little chatty. Thank you for letting me come and share from my heart, because we have 17 days. Ohio always looms large in national elections. You know, we over in Indiana look a little bit jealous from time to time. I mean, it seems like as Ohio goes, so the nation goes. And I'm incredibly proud of the fact that a recent national poll, the third one in a row, came out and Donald Trump is leading in the race for president and leading in the state of Ohio. But there's work to be done. But there's work to be done, and I want to challenge you in that regard. First off, I want to challenge you to go tell somebody. I mean, the truth of the matter is, you know, I mentioned earlier, you know, it's like two-on-one every day with the national media doing half of Hillary Clinton's work for her. But the amazing thing is this movement continues to grow. I'll be in Cleveland tonight with Donald Trump. So far, we're expecting nearly 10,000 people. There'll probably be another 5,000 that won't be able to get in the door. I mean, the enthusiasm, momentum of this movement is very humbling. It's humbling to him as well. I remember when we were in a small town here in Ohio on Labor Day, and we pulled into the fairgrounds where there wasn't even a rally. There wasn't even an organized event. Some 50,000 Buckeyes had all come out just to give a wave or give a thumbs up or wear a red hat to encourage the next president of the United States. It's truly humbling. And at those moments, Donald will invariably look at me and he'll say, remember, Mike, this is not about me and it's not about us. He said, this is a movement of the American people, and the American people are going to make America great again. That's what's going to happen here. But you got to tell somebody. You got to tell somebody. You got to leave here today and you got to tell people. And you know, I can't help but think of some words that Ronald Reagan said at the National Association of Evangelicals back in the 1980s. He said words that I think resonate today. He said, quote, I urge you to beware the temptation of pride, the temptation of blithely declaring yourselves above it all and label both sides equally at fault. Close quote. I mean, when we're talking to people in our communities of faith, I think laying out the choice in this election, security and prosperity and values, it's imperative for every single one of us to do that, because it's just that important in the life of the nation. Secondly, I encourage you to be involved. In the 17 days that remain, if you got one of those good-looking red hats, don't take it off. Sleep in that thing. go out and get involved in the campaign. If you're not out yet knocking on doors, if you're not somewhere sitting and making some phone calls, I was in New Hampshire yesterday, stopped by a call center. I'm going to do one in Ohio today. I mean, the people that are in there literally making thousands of phone calls. I mean, when neighbors hear from neighbors and friends hear from friends, that's what makes all the difference. And I know the media has been very critical of my running mate for suggesting that voter fraud ever happens in this country. But I would encourage you, if you're coming to an event like this, if you're concerned about the future of the country and you haven't yet signed up to respectfully participate on polling day, on election day itself, and ensuring the integrity of the vote, I encourage you to do that as well. Our states govern and operate our elections, but the integrity of the vote is the bedrock of our democracy, and it's citizens participating and ensuring the integrity of that vote that always makes the difference. So let's make this election day not just a victory for our team, not just a victory for our movement. Let's make it a victory for American democracy by being involved every day and on election day. You know, the choice in this election could not be more clear. It's really change versus the status quo. Or as Ronald Reagan said back in 1964, it's really not a choice between left and right, or even Republican and Democrat. It's a choice between up and down. I mean, this is a choice, think about it this way, when you go talk to your neighbors and friends, this is a choice between whether we're going to continue to go downhill to a weaker America on the world stage, a hollowed out American military with receding influence on the world stage, a stifled American economy, an America walking farther and farther away from our most cherished constitutional ideals, or whether we're going to stop and plant our feet and turn around and march back up the hill to a stronger America at home and abroad, respected in the world, prosperous at home, and standing without apology on our highest constitutional ideals. That's the choice that we have in this election, men and women. And that's what you got to go tell people.
Do I turn that on? Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome
believers in the
Lieutenant
room.
General retired Keith Kellogg.
Good morning. Mr. Trump is en route. He should be here very, very shortly. So they sent me out here to kind of quell the crowd down a little bit as we're going forward. First of all, good morning, and thanks for being here today. I'm a retired Army guy, and I can't think of a more historic place than to be here in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. And to me, and not only is it a historic place, it's really a historic time in our lives. You know, when you think of Gettysburg, the name brings up memories of our great nation's strife, of a time when the future of our nation was in doubt, in a time in our nation's history where brother fought brother, and state fought state, and the outcome uncertain in 1863. And it came to a culminating point here in Gettysburg when Union forces defeated the invading Confederate Army under Robert E. Lee in July of 1863. While the force of arms decided the day and saved the Union, one man, through his words and leadership, brought us together just a few short months later, in November of 1863, when President Abraham Lincoln said through their last full measure of devotion, a nation of the people and by the people and for the people was preserved. Today, 153 years later, we are waging another battle, a political one, one that will determine the future of this nation again. And again, much of the nation's eyes will be on Pennsylvania as it votes. You and the Keystone State, a state where three of our most treasured documents, the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, and the Gettysburg Address were all written. Pennsylvania, one of the three original colonies, and today you hold a critical position in determining this nation's path again. We need your help. And of all the Americans watching today and those in Pennsylvania watching, I'm asking you to join our crusade for making this nation great again, to have a government that you can be proud of, which means a government unlike those of our opponent, one who believes it is her right to govern, and who says of those who support her, "I'm with her." There's a difference. You see, Mr. Trump in the campaign, we're with you. So you have a choice, and this nation has a choice. And the difference could not be more clear. From the Supreme Court, immigration, inner cities, jobs in our economy, trade, law enforcement, the differences are stark and they're very clear. The differences from belief in entitlement to one who realizes that the White House is the people's house and belongs to the people of Washington, Kansas, or Grand Junction, Colorado, are those of Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and not the special interests of money, of elitism, of arrogance, or corruption found at the highest levels. We are at a crossroads of history. We will either have more of the same with establishment entitlement and sheer arrogance of power to a new direction that is focused on America first, her people first. And I am very proud to be part of that team. And you should be as well. Donald Trump has consistently laid out his views on immigration and foreign affairs, trade, veterans affairs, the Supreme Court. His campaign is one of ideas, of bringing the greatness out in our nation, and yet his efforts seem to be belittled by some. And the reason is because they are afraid. They are afraid that the self-entitled, the political elites, the special interests are all under attack. And they are. Because we intend to change the way the nation is governed. I am proud to stand with him. I am honored to be part of his team. And as a retired officer, it's just not me. There's over 200 retired flag officers with me, to include 23 Medal of Honor recipients. We know leadership. We know temperament. And we know what's in his heart. These are just not idle words from somebody like me, because many of us have skin in the game. We have sons. We have daughters. We have friends who serve in the military. My youngest son is a platoon leader in the 82nd Airborne Division. In just a few months, he will deploy to Afghanistan. So is it serious to someone like me? Yes, it is. Donald Trump did not have to do this. He is a successful businessman, not a politician. He is a building of towering buildings that reach for the skies. He is a leader who promotes the best, regardless of race, regardless of religion, regardless of ethnicity. In his own way, Donald Trump challenges us to send him people to match those buildings that soar to the heavens. But we need your help. We are in a fight. And it is a fight that will determine the path of this nation for generations. It involves the Supreme Court. It involves our borders. It involves immigration. It involves economy. It involves jobs. It involves international trade and international affairs. And we are opposed by the same special interests in the overwhelming majority of the mainstream media, whether we like it or not. But the choice is clear. The choice to us is clear. If you like the past 8, 12, 16 years, then vote for her. If you believe this nation is better off with her views of you and this nation, then vote for her. But if you believe in this nation, if you believe in America first and in making America great again, your path is incredibly clear. And you need to commit yourselves for the next 3 weeks to elect Donald J. Trump, President of the United States. I'm honored, and I'm privileged to be with him, and he will be with you shortly. Thank you for your patience, and God bless you all. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome America's Mayor, Rudy Giuliani.
Thank you very much. Thank you. We apologize for being late, but the weather didn't cooperate, and we probably would have gotten here faster if we just drove straight from New York. So, I've come to Gettysburg often, and usually I drive here because the roads are so historic, whether you come from Washington or you come from New York. But you can't come to Gettysburg and not realize that you're in hallowed ground, very special place, sanctified by the blood of so many Americans, divided as never before or since, all believing in their cause. The Union remained, and the verdict of history determined the morality of the cause. It took a long time to heal the wounds and right the wrongs of slavery. and some still remain and must be healed. But as important as the Battle of Gettysburg was the words that Lincoln very modestly and humbly said, the world will little note nor long remember. Well, the world has all heard it and they all remember it. And maybe it's one of the great definitions of our democracy, one of the great pillars of our democracy, the words, government of the people, by the people, and for the people, shall not perish from this earth. Well, that's why Donald Trump is running for president, to take government away from the special interests, the massive donors, the lobbyists, the Washington insiders. I don't know that I could call government right now of the people, for the people, and by the people. I think it's government of the lobbyists, the permanent politicians that are there forever, 30 years, 40 years, the big, gigantic, multinational corporations, and the unions that can donate enormous amounts of money. People are kind of down there somewhere. They get promised stuff and then the politicians don't deliver it. Then the people are upset and we have this terrible feeling about all politicians, don't we? We look at the polls, how are you laughing? We look at the polls and I don't know who's rated worse, politicians or reporters. Pretty close. Way down. And that's why Donald Trump began this journey a long time ago and with little chance of winning. He thought, given the fact that he's his own man, his own person, doesn't need the contributions and doesn't need all the people around him that his opponent has who have bought and sold her for years and years. One thing about Donald Trump, whether you like what he says or you don't, it's what he says and nobody's paying for it or buying it or telling him to say it. He's his own man. He's his own man with his own ideas. And his big idea is to return government to you, the people, to clean out Washington. To him, you know, you're not the abominables and the irredeemables. To her, you are. You're who she's talking about. You're the abominables and the irredeemables. Me too, by the way, so don't feel bad. I may be an abominable with a capital A to her. But Donald Trump doesn't look at it that way. He sees you as the backbone of America, the people who, you know, give up their lives to save our country when it's needed, the people who protect us as police officers and firefighters, the people who produce our food and our products and our... You're the people that make America work. You're the real heart of America, not the people sitting in the ivory tower thinking all day. Sometimes they think so much, they come up with very stupid thoughts. Donald Trump is running to clean those people out. They've been in Washington for too long. And he's come here actually to, and he could think of no more appropriate place to do it, to lay out a contract with you as to what he's going to achieve in his first 100 days along the road of returning the government to the people. Very specific, the things that he's going to do to turn this government around and finally, clean it out so that it works for you the way Abraham Lincoln believed so nobly so many years ago when he spoke here. So thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Donald J. Trump.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Please sit down. Thank you. Thank you. It's my privilege to be here in Gettysburg, hallowed ground where so many lives were given in service to freedom. Amazing place. President Lincoln served in a time of division like we've never seen before. It is my hope that we can look at his example to heal the divisions we are living through right now. We are a very divided nation. I'm not a politician and have never wanted to be a politician. Believe me. But when I saw the trouble our country was in, I knew I couldn't stand by and watch any longer. Our country has been so good to me. I love our country, and I felt I had to act. I've seen the system up close and personal for many years. I've been a major part of it. I know how the game works in Washington and on Wall Street, and I know how they've rigged the rules of the game against everyday Americans. The rules are rigged. Nearly one in four Americans in their prime earning years isn't even working. One in five households have no one with a job. 45 million Americans are on food stamps, and 47 million are living in poverty. We have failed our inner cities, and in so doing, have failed our African American and Hispanic communities. We've misguided military adventures overseas and wars that go on forever that just cannot be won by the people that are doing it now. They don't know how to win the wars. At home, we have our great veterans dying while waiting for medical care. Change has to come from outside our very broken system. Our system is broken. The fact that Washington and the Washington establishment has tried so hard to stop our campaign is only more proof that our campaign represents the kind of change that only arrives once in a lifetime. The system is totally rigged and broken. First, the issue of voter fraud. According to Pew, there are 24 million voter registrations in the United States that are either invalid or significantly inaccurate. And when I say that, there are such inaccuracies, it's unbelievable. 1.8 million dead people are registered to vote. And some of them are voting. I wonder how that happens. 2.8 million people are registered in more than one state. These are numbers, folks. These are numbers. 14% of non-citizens are registered to vote. The system is also rigged because Hillary Clinton should have been precluded from running for the presidency of the United States. But the FBI and the Justice Department covered up her crimes which included lying to the FBI and Congress on numerous occasions, and included saying, I do not recall, to the FBI on 39 separate times. She recalls everything else, but 39 separate times she said, I do not recall. Well, that's a lie also. Then there is the deletion of at least 33,000 emails after receiving a subpoena from the United States Congress. That's after receiving the subpoena. As an example, it was announced this week that the highly respected four-star general, James Cartwright, may be sentenced to up to 5 years in prison with a massive fine for lying on one occasion to the FBI. And he said he did that for national security reasons. Highly respected man, a four-star general. This took place 2 days ago. How must he feel? A big part of the rigging of this election is the fact that Hillary is being allowed to run despite having broken so many laws on so many different occasions. Why is she allowed to run? The dishonest mainstream media is also part and a major part of this corruption. They're corrupt. They lie and fabricate stories to make a candidate that is not their preferred choice look as bad and even dangerous as possible. At my rallies, they never show or talk about the massive crowd size and try to diminish all of our events. On the other hand, they don't show the small size of Hillary's crowds, but in fact, talk about how many people are there. Very small crowds. You know it. They know it. Everybody knows it. Over the last 2 days, three highly respected national polls said we're in first place. And one of those pollsters was the most accurate poll on the last two cycles. But the media refuses to even say it or put that word out. They refuse to talk about it. They're trying desperately to suppress my vote and the voice of the American people. As an example of the power structure I'm fighting, AT&T is buying Time Warner and thus CNN, a deal we will not approve in my administration because it's too much concentration of power in the hands of too few. Likewise, Amazon, which through its ownership controls the Washington Post, should be paying massive taxes, but it's not paying. And it's a very unfair playing field. And you see what that's happening and what that's doing to department stores all over the country. Very, very unfair. And you're talking about billions and billions of dollars. They should be paying those taxes. Additionally, Comcast's purchase of NBC concentrates far too much power in one massive entity that is trying to tell the voters what to think and what to do. Deals like this destroy democracy. And we'll look at breaking that deal up and other deals like that. This should never, ever have been approved in the first place. They're trying to poison the mind of the American voter. Every woman lied when they came forward to hurt my campaign. Total fabrication. The events never happened, never. All of these liars will be sued after the election is over. But a simple phone call placed to the biggest newspapers or television networks gets them wall-to-wall coverage with virtually no fact-checking whatsoever. Here is why this is relevant to you. If they can fight somebody like me, who has unlimited resources to fight back, just look at what they can do to you, your jobs, your security, your education, your health care, the violation of religious liberty, the theft of your Second Amendment, the loss of your factories, your homes, and much more. Look at what they've done to you with your jobs. It has just been learned on video that the violent protests at some of my rallies, like in Chicago, where police and others were seriously hurt, you saw that, blood pouring down their face, were caused by paid DNC and Clinton campaign operatives. Now, we didn't know this. We didn't know this. This just came out 2 days ago on tape. We didn't know this. We were amazed at the level of violence. These were paid operatives, paid by the DNC and probably the Clinton campaign. This is a criminal act. Policemen were badly hurt, and so were many others. And these people should be prosecuted. But because of the rigged system, they probably won't be. Just like we found out about these paid violent protesters, it was probably the DNC and the Clinton campaign that put forward these liars with their fabricated stories. But we'll find out about their involvement at a later date through litigation, and I look so forward to doing it. The rigging of the system is designed for one reason: to keep the corrupt establishment and special interests in power at your expense, at everybody's expense. I have no special interest but you, the American voter. I didn't have to do this, believe me. There's nothing easy about it. But I had to do it. I love our country. I love the people of our country. And I felt I had to do it. Thank you. One thing we all know is that we will never solve our problems by relying on the same politicians who created these problems in the first place. Hillary Clinton is not running against me. She's running against change. And she's running against all of the American people and all of the American voters. We now find ourselves at that very special fork in the road. Do we repeat the mistakes of the past, or do we choose to believe that a great future, yet unwritten, still lies ahead for us and for our wonderful, beloved country? I think it does. I know it does. My economic plan will deliver at least 25 million jobs in one decade. Now, our jobs have been taken away. They've gone to Mexico. They've gone to so many other countries. It's a one-lane highway where they get the jobs, they get the factories, they get the money, and we get the drugs, and we get the unemployment. And it's going to change, believe me, and it's going to change fast. And that goes for all countries. When you look at China, when you look at every country, every trade deal we have is horrible. And we should be ashamed of a people and the people that let those deals happen. They're defective, and they knew they were defective, and they were done for a reason. And believe me, they will be unwound so fast. And we will have trade. We will have great trade. And it'll be free trade. But it'll be fair trade, and it'll be real. My security plan, so important. They've taken the jobs from us. My security plan will bring safety to our poorest communities. My ethics plan will end the corruption in our government. The corruption is massive. We will drain the swamp in Washington, D.C. and replace it with a new government of, by, and for the people. Believe me. That is why I have chosen Gettysburg to unveil this contract. I'm asking the American people to rise above the noise and the clutter of our broken politics and to embrace that great faith and optimism that has always been the central ingredient in the American character. And there is nothing better or stronger than the American character. I am asking the American people to dream big once again. What follows is my 100-day action plan to make America great again. It's a contract between Donald J. Trump and the American voter, and it begins with bringing honesty, accountability, and change to Washington, D.C. Therefore, on the first day of my term of office, my administration will immediately pursue the following 6 measures to clean up the corruption and special interest collusion in Washington. First, a constitutional amendment to impose term limits on all members of Congress. Second, a hiring freeze on all federal employees to reduce federal workforce through attrition, exempting military, public safety, and public health. Third, a requirement that for every new federal regulation, 2 existing regulations must be eliminated. Regulations are killing our country and our jobs. Fourth, a 5-year ban on White House and congressional officials becoming lobbyists after they leave government service, making a fortune. Fifth, a lifetime ban on White House officials lobbying on behalf of a foreign government. Very bad. Six, a complete ban on foreign lobbyists raising money for American elections. That's what's happening. On the same day, I will begin taking strongly 7 actions to protect American workers. Our American workers have been treated so badly by politicians that don't have their interests at heart. And we're going to change that. We're going to change that very, very fast. First, I will announce my intention to totally renegotiate NAFTA, one of the worst deals our country has ever made, signed by Bill Clinton, or withdraw from the deal under Article 2205. Second, I will announce our withdrawal from the Trans-Pacific Partnership, a potential disaster for our country. Third, I will direct my Secretary of the Treasury to label China a currency manipulator. China is a currency manipulator. What they have done to us by playing currency is very sad, and I don't blame them. They've been very smart. I blame our politicians for letting this take place. So easy to stop. So easy to stop. Fourth, I will direct the Secretary of Commerce and U.S. Trade Representative to identify all foreign trading abuses that unfairly impact American workers and direct them to use every tool under American and international law to end those abuses immediately. Fifth, very importantly, I will lift the restrictions on the production of $50 trillion worth of job-producing American energy reserves, including including shale, oil, natural gas, and clean coal. And we will put our miners back to work. Sixth, I will lift the Obama-Clinton roadblocks that allow for this vital energy infrastructure projects to go forward. We have roadblocks like you've never, ever seen. Environmental blocks, structural blocks. We're going to allow the Keystone Pipeline and so many other things to move forward. Tremendous numbers of jobs and good for our country. We're going to cancel billions in payments to the United Nations climate change programs and use the money to fix America's water and environmental infrastructure. We're paying billions and billions and billions of dollars. We're going to fix our own environment. Yeah. Additionally, on the first day, I will take the following five actions to restore security and constitutional rule of law. We have to do that. Cancel every unconstitutional executive action, memorandum, and order issued by President Obama. Second, begin the process of selecting a replacement for Justice Scalia, whose wife, by the way, has a Trump sign. His wife is a phenomenal woman. Has a Trump sign in her front yard. Isn't that nice? I just found that out this morning. Boom. Isn't that nice? He was great. From one of the 20 judges on my list, you know we're going to make great decisions from 20 outstanding judges on a list that we submitted, who will uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States. Third, we will cancel all federal funding of sanctuary cities. Fourth, we will begin removing the more than 2 million criminal illegal immigrants from the country. These are drug dealers, gang heads, gang members, killers, and cancel visas to foreign countries that won't take them back. And when Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State, and they had someone who was bad, really bad, and they brought him back to the country and the country wouldn't take him, she said, well, bring him back. We don't want to force the country to take him. There won't be one such instance if I become president, believe me. We're going to suspend immigration from terror-prone regions where vetting cannot safely occur. And if you look at Syria and the migration, we're taking in thousands and thousands of people into our country. We have no idea who they are, what their thought process is, where they come from. And Hillary Clinton wants to increase the number of those thousands and thousands currently pouring in by 550%. Radical Islamic terror is right around the corner. We have to be so tough, so smart, so vigilant. We can't allow that to happen. We have enough problems. All vetting of people coming into our country will be considered extreme vetting. We will be very careful. Next, I will work with Congress to introduce the following broader legislative measures and fight for their passage within the first 100 days of my administration. Middle-class tax relief and simplification act. An economic plan designed to grow the economy 4% per year and create at least 25 million new jobs through massive tax reduction and simplification in combination with trade reform, regulatory relief, and lifting the restrictions on American energy. Need that so badly. Jobs. We need jobs. Our jobs have left us. Our good jobs have really left us. The largest tax reductions are for the middle class, who have been forgotten. Called the forgotten man and woman. They have been forgotten. The middle class with family of two children will get basically approximately a 35% tax cut. And that's what they can use. And that money will go back into the economy. The current number of brackets will be reduced from 7 to 3. And tax forms will likewise be greatly simplified. The business rate will be lowered from 35% to 15%, and the trillions of dollars of American corporate money overseas can now be brought back at a 10% rate. It's stuck. We can't bring it back. $2.5 to $5 trillion. Companies can't get it back into the country. Some companies are actually leaving, not only because taxes are so high, but because they can't get their money, and they are actually leaving to get their money. We are going to simplify that. We're going to have them bring the money back into our country and use the money and spend the money on building our country. End the Offshoring Act. Establish tariffs to discourage companies from laying off their workers in order to relocate in other countries and ship their products back to the United States tax-free. They leave the United States, like Carrier, like Ford, like so many others. They leave the United States. They fire all of their employees. They go to Mexico or another country. They build a beautiful brand new plant. They hire other people. They then take their air conditioners, their cars, whatever they're making. They send it tax-free across what will be a very strong border, believe me. But they send it tax-free across the border. And what do we end up with? We have unemployment, tremendous losses, and we have none of the benefits. So we will establish tariffs that when they do that, there will be consequences. We'll work with them, we'll be nice, we'll be fair, but there have to be consequences. And when they know there are consequences, our companies will stop leaving the United States and going to other countries. The American Infrastructure Act leverages public-private partnerships and private investments through tax incentives to spur $1 trillion in infrastructure investment over the next 10 years. Our infrastructure is in such trouble. We've doubled our national debt to $20 trillion under President Obama. In less than 8 years, $10 trillion has been added. Think of it. And we haven't fixed anything. We haven't fixed anything. What have we done? Our roads are broken, our bridges, our tunnels, our hospitals, our schools. And we have $20 trillion in debt, all-time high. That's true. Our VA hospitals are in bad shape, and our VA is in very, very bad shape. And we will fix that. We are going to work on fixing that because our veterans have not been treated properly. We have illegal immigrants that are treated far better in many instances than our veterans, and we're not going to have that. School Choice and Education Opportunity Act redirects education dollars to give parents the right to send their kid, their children, to public, private, charter, magnet, religious, or home schools of their choice. And so importantly, we're going to end Common Core and bring education supervision to local communities. We do so badly on education. If you look at the lists and you see Sweden, Norway, Denmark, China, different countries at the top, you see us at the bottom. And yet, by far, per pupil, more money than anybody, and it's not even close. We spend more money per pupil than anybody, not even close. We're at the bottom of the list other countries spending far less per pupil are at the top of the list. So obviously, our current system is not working. We will change it, and we will make it good. It expands vocational and technical education, which we've totally forgotten about in this country, and make 2- and 4-year colleges more affordable. Have you ever gone to school and you've been with people that aren't good students, but they can fix an engine, or they can build a wall, or they can do things that you wouldn't even think about? Because we can use some of the ones that build the wall. We're going to need them. We're going to need them. We're going to need them. But did you ever see that? How they're genius at fixing a car. They can do anything. But history, not so good. Physics, not so good. I mean, we have to open vocational again. Those are the people. These are great people. The Repeal and Replace Obamacare Act. Fully repeal Obamacare and replace it with health savings accounts. So we can do that. The health savings accounts, it's one way. There are numerous ways, but this is one very good way. The ability to purchase health insurance across state lines, which we have to do because that's competition. The politicians won't let go of it because the insurance companies, they don't want competition. But we'll open it up. Believe me, we'll get rid of that. I've been saying it for years. And let states manage Medicaid funds. It will be so good. Reforms will also include cutting the red tape at the FDA. There are over 4,000 drugs awaiting approval, and we especially want to speed the approval of life-saving medications. I mean, they're looking at drugs that are looking very good, and you have terminal patients that it's over. These people, they're dying. They want to get the drug. They won't be living much longer. And we study it for years and years. At some point, they have to do what they have to do. They have to do it properly. But we have 4,000 different drugs and products waiting in line for approval, and we can't get them approved. We're going to speed up that process very significantly. Affordable Child Care and Elder Care Act allows Americans to deduct child care and elder care from their taxes, incentivizes employers to provide on-site, and so important, child care services. And you see that with a couple of companies, and it's such a great thing to see. And creates tax-free dependent care savings accounts for both young and elderly dependents with matching contributions for low-income families. So good. End Illegal Immigration Act. Fully funds the construction of a wall on our southern border. Don't worry about it. Remember, I said Mexico's paying for the wall. With the full understanding that the country of Mexico will be reimbursing the United States for the full cost of such a wall. Okay? We're going to have the wall. Mexico's going to pay for the wall. Mexico's, by the way, I met with the president of Mexico 2.5 months ago. Wonderful meeting, wonderful person. But I told him, this is a two-way highway, not a one-way highway. We have our people. We have to take care of our people. We have to protect our people. So it's got to be a two-way street. Otherwise, it's going to be a whole different deal. But it establishes a 2-year mandatory minimum federal prison sentence. This is people coming in illegally for illegally reentering the United States after a previous deportation, and a 5-year mandatory minimum for illegally reentering for those with felony convictions, multiple misdemeanor convictions, or 2 or more prior deportations. So when somebody comes in, we send them out. They come back in, they go to prison for quite a while. They come back again, they go 5 years. Because what's happening is they're coming back 10 times. And I could go case after case. They come back, look at what happened in San Francisco. 5 times he came back. On the 5th time, he killed Kate. 5 times. But so many others. One 10 times came back. Killed somebody after 10 times. When they get deported, they stay out. Otherwise, they have very serious prison terms. They will stay out. Once you do that, they will stay out. Right now, they have no consequence. They have no consequences. Also, reforms on visa rules to enhance penalties for overstaying and to ensure open jobs are offered to American workers first. Number 8, Restoring Community Safety Act reduces surging crime, drugs, and violence by creating a task force on violent crime and increasing funding for programs that train and assist your local police who are doing such a great job, believe me. We increase the resources for federal law enforcement agencies and federal prosecutors to dismantle criminal gangs and put violent offenders behind bars or out of our country and into the country where they came from. Restoring National Security Act, which rebuilds our military by eliminating the defense sequester, which has been very tough on our military, and expanding military investment. Now, at no time practically do we need a military like right now. We don't want to use it, but it's peace through strength. We need a strong military. Our military is so terribly depleted. It also provides our great veterans with the ability to receive public VA treatment or attend a private doctor of their choice. If they're waiting online, and I have the plan up, and we've gotten, as you know, tremendous support from veterans, from law enforcement, from veterans, from the military, tremendous support. But if they're waiting online, and you see it, 22 suicides a day, people don't even believe it, 22 a day. But if they're waiting online for 7 days, 6 days, 9 days, they can't get to see a doctor, and a simple procedure or a simple prescription can solve their problem, and they become very sick, and they die. They die waiting online. We're going to give them the power to go across the street to a local doctor, a private doctor, a public hospital, or a private hospital, all looking to help and all looking to do business. And we'll pay the bill so much cheaper, but much more importantly, the veterans will finally be taken care of properly, because what they're going through now is unacceptable. Also, we're going to protect our vital infrastructure from the new thing. It's called cyber attack. It establishes new screening procedures for immigration to ensure those who are admitted to our country support our people and our values. We want people that love our country or can love our country, and people that will love our citizens. We want people that can love us. And there are ways through talent of determining that, and other countries do, but we don't. Just come on in, folks, come on in. Clean Up Corruption in Washington Act enacts tough new ethic reforms to reduce the corrupting influence of special interests and donors on our politics. On November 8th, Americans will be voting for this 100-day plan to restore prosperity to our country, secure our communities, and honesty to our government. This is my pledge to you. And if we follow these steps, we will once more have a government of, by, and for the people. And importantly, we will make America great again. Believe me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Donald J. Trump wrapping up remarks in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. Some are billing this as his Gettysburg address. 55,000 strong. Thank you to our viewers for watching and choosing RSBN as your source. I want to remind everybody that RSBN is live. Our crews are live today in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and also Cleveland, Ohio tonight. You can tune in and watch. Our cameras are the only one that shows the crowds. Remember that. We are completely supported by you, the viewer. So please support us at rsbn.tv/donate. We are going to be at every single Trump rally between now and the election. Every single one that we are at, we will be live streaming. We've been able to upgrade our equipment because of you, and now we will be broadcasting live from anywhere in the country. We'll follow Trump. We're going to actually also be at some Donald Trump Jr. events next week in Arizona, so we'll be able to give you exclusive access there. So thank you all again for tuning in. A record-breaking day here this morning to watch this historic speech. And we will be back at 3 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time, live from Regent University in Virginia Beach, Virginia, as Donald Trump will address supporters there. And then tonight at 7 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time, Donald Trump and Governor Mike Pence will both be live from Cleveland at the IX Center.